Last time we started to talk about the persistence methods for Cisma CD. We talked about three different strategies. The first one is when we continuously sense the channel, and then once the channel is once we find that the channel is idle, we access the channel's probability of one. And we said that there are two problems in this case: the overhead in sensing the channel very frequently, and at the same time, by accessing the channel immediately, we increase the probability of collision. We tried to solve these in this second strategy, where we sense the channel at different wait times. So if we find that the channel is idle, we wait, and then we wait for some time, and this time is similar to the back-off procedure. Okay, if we find that the channel is busy again, then we wait for a longer time, and so on. And by doing this, we will reduce the overhead in terms of sensing the channel. However, we might actually miss some chance to access the channel while the channel is idle, and we call that delay or a latency in accessing the channel, which will reduce the channel utilization. So we tried to combine the two concepts by using the P-persistence strategy. So similar to the first strategy, we will continuously sense the channel, but if the channel is idle, then we have to generate a random number. And if this random number is less than P, that's why we call it P-persistent, only then we will access the channel. Otherwise, we wait for a time slot, a fixed time slot, and then we try again. We sense the channel is idle. If the channel is idle, then we generate a random number, and so on and so forth. The random number tries to maintain the fact that the two nodes will not generate the same random number, in which case it will reduce the possibility of collision. But at the same time, if the channel is idle, I should not waste time in accessing the channel, because this will reduce the channel utilization. So that's the flow chart for the three strategies. For the one persistent, it's very simple. We keep asking ourselves, is the channel idle? If the channel is busy, we keep sensing, and once the channel is idle, we access. Here, if the channel is busy, then we wait for a random wait time. This random wait time is similar to the back-off procedure. And then we go back again and we ask ourselves, is the channel really idle? Once the channel is idle, then we access the channel. And that might delay the access to the channel in some cases. Then here, once the channel is idle, then we generate a random number. If this random number is less than P, then we access the channel right away. Otherwise, if it's not P, then we wait. This time is not a random wait time. It's actually a fixed wait time. And then we ask ourselves again. And then if the channel is idle, we do the same. We generate the random outcome, and so on. Meshi? And in all cases, if there is any collision, then we engage in back-off procedure. So going back to the space-time model, if we assume that node A is sending at time T1, its first bit of the frame, okay? Then this bit or any part of the frame will propagate through the cable, okay, and will reach at different points at different times, depending on the propagation speed. Okay, so node C starts to listen here. It doesn't listen to the signal coming from A, so it will start to send, and the collision will happen. The earliest time that the collision happens is here. At this time, at this location. This is the earliest time the collision is has ever happened. Okay? But the signal sent from C will arrive to A at time T4. Okay? So that's the space-time model that we have discussed before. So now, we have other questions. So the transmission time of A, assuming that A is sending a frame of a particular length, will take some transmission time, and this transmission time depends on the length of the data that you're trying to send, right? So now the question is, if A spends more time in transmitting that it goes beyond T4, okay? Then in that case, A will detect the collision at time T4. What will it do then? Or what should it do then?
Stop transmitting.
Bravo, Alec. There's no point of engaging into transmission that it's deemed to fail. Right? صح? There's no point. I'm wasting time. So at time T4, I will stop. Stop and then engage back in back-off procedures similar to what we've talked about. طيب. So the other subsequent question is, what if A finished transmission of the frame here before T4, right before T4? Well, this question has two sub-questions now. Just the fact that A finished the transmission of the frame before T4, does that mean that the collision did not happen? It happened, صح? It did happen, صح? طيب, the collision happened. طيب. The other sub-question is, what will A do in that case?
Eh? She doesn't know that collision.
The collision happened, صح? Because it listened to the signal at time T4. Before time T4, it finished the frame transmission. So what will it do?
Wait for acknowledgement?
Yeah, nothing. Just wait for acknowledgement. صح, بالضبط. Just wait for acknowledgement and that's it. But as far as this phase is concerned, I will consider this frame is a sent. Alas, and I will have to wait for a very long time until the timeout expires to figure out whether there was an error, there was a collision. And at this time, T4, I did not detect any collision because my signal is done. Okay? So ideally, I need the frame transmission time to be more than T4 minus T1. So that once I engage in transmission, okay, if the collision happened at T4, I will detect that it happened and I will stop transmission. Otherwise, I will continue transmitting and then I will wait for whether or not I receive the acknowledgement in order to retransmit. Okay? So the frame time should be more than this T4 minus T1. So we want to calculate back what is the worst case for this T4 minus T1. We want to calculate this. In that case, we need to consider the worst case scenario. صح? Because T4 minus T1 is based on the distance between C and A. Okay, so the worst case is when C is the farthest. Okay? And it's also based on the fact that when exactly C sends. So we'll talk about this. So if A detects, if A is sending more than one bit, yani is sending a frame, if it detects that collision has happened at time T4, it will stop transmitting. Similarly, C detected the collision at time T3 and it will stop transmitting. So both A and C, they will detect the collision successfully, hopefully, yani, with high probability. Yani. And then they will abstain from continuing to transmit and everything will be fine. But this is based on the fact that this transmission time has to go beyond T4. So what is the worst case for this T4 minus T1? So first we have to imagine the worst case scenario that A and D, why D? Because D is the farthest, right? So A and D have the longest distance between each other. So this will definitely give me some indication about the worst case scenario. So in that case, when A sends at time T1, D will have it at time T5. Let's say T5. Okay? So at time T5, after time T5, if D has data to send, it will listen to the signal from B, so it will not send anything. Okay? So this will be taken care of. But imagine that if D, right before T5, yani 1 nanosecond before T5, since this is a channel, it will find it idle, so it will send. So the signal from D will arrive at time T6. Okay? This is the worst case scenario. So the signal from A arrives to D, which is the farthest node. So this is what is this time? This is the longest propagation time. صح? And then at this time, D started to send, which will take another longest propagation time. So what is the condition now? So again, if A finished before T6, that's not good because A will prematurely decide that the frame has been transmitted successfully, whereas it didn't because the collision has happened. So we always want the nodes to detect if the collision ever happened, rather than having to wait for a very, very long time for the acknowledgement to come or not to come. So in that case, the condition is...
frame should be greater than TB minus T1.
TA?
T6 minus
T1. اللي هو كام بقى؟ اللي هو قد ايه يعني؟ اللي هو...
TB minus
2 TB. 2 TP. ما هو ده TP اهو. And this one is TP again. So from here to here is TP. And from here to here is TP. تمام؟ So the frame transmission time should be greater than or equal to double the propagation time. In fact, we have talked to you about this in 455. When we told you that for Ethernet, the minimum frame length equals to 512 bits. And we stopped at this point and we give it to you as a fact. We give it to you as a fact. We did not tell you why. Okay? So this is why. Because the nodes should send a frame long enough that allows them to detect the collision if it ever happened while they are transmitting. Because if they finish transmission before they detect the collision, then they will prematurely decide that there was no collision, even though it happened. So we want the nodes not to finish the transmission before the collision ever happens, if any. Okay? So in order for this to happen, in order for this to be true, then this condition must hold. So the frame transmission should be greater than or equal to double the propagation time. Whereas the propagation time is based on the longest distance. What is the maximum distance for a cable, for UTP cable? Fakrin,
100 meters.
Bravo, Ali, 100 meters. So we can easily calculate the propagation time for 100 meters. Scenario, here. So while A is transmitting, A needs to A to monitor whether another node has transmitted, in which case there is a collision. In this line, when is the earliest time that the collision happened? Here. If we are lucky enough to have node E at this point exactly, this node E will be able to detect the collision the earliest. The earliest, right? In that case, E will send a jamming signal to everyone. Okay? And this jamming signal is good. Why? Because on one hand, all the nodes, they will stop transmitting. They will not keep transmitting forever for no reason. There's no point. Okay? Two, it will allow all these nodes to engage and back off as early as possible, without having to wait for not receiving the acknowledgement, this which takes a long time. Meshi? Okay. So for 100 meters, the propagation time turns out to be around 25.6 microseconds. So we can calculate that based on the distance and the propagation speed. صح? That's easy. We know how to do this. So the propagation time is around 25.6 microseconds. So now, what is the minimum frame length? It's based on the minimum transmission time. صح? And the minimum transmission time is L divided by the bandwidth. Right? So this has to be equal to 2 times the propagation time, which is this. So in that case, L equals to 2 TP times B. 2 TP is 51.2 microseconds. Times the bandwidth, which is 10, so that turns out to be 512 bits. Okay? Because the bandwidth is 10 megabits per second, not megabytes. It's 10 megabits per second. Okay? So 512 bits, which is around 64 bytes. If you subtract the header length of the network layer, which is around 20 bytes. So that leaves the data part to be around 44 bytes. This is the minimum data part, okay, that should come from the transport layer.
One frame can feed the whole medium?
One frame can fill the full medium? بمعنى ايه ما احنا قلنا بقى ال length ده اللي هو ال bandwidth delay product okay so depending on the bandwidth delay product one frame can definitely fill the entire line yes ماشي And we صح, and what you are saying is true. We need the frame to really fill the entire line. Okay? And in that case, the delay, the bandwidth delay product, the delay part is 2p, at least 2p. Okay? So that the frame can fill the entire line during the time required for the signal to go all the way and come back. Okay, so this way, if the collision ever happens, we will detect it. So based on this, the flow chart for the Cisma CD We see some differences with Aloha. Like we see this part is very similar, صح? This is the back-off procedure. We know the back-off procedure is quite similar. It's based on exponential random back-off. We know this part. That's easy. In case of collision, then we do it. The good thing here is that we can detect the collision. This is one main difference. In Aloha, we could not detect the collision at all. Imagine? And we use the implicit procedure of not receiving the acknowledgement to know whether the collision has happened or any error has happened. The main flow here but has some differences. The first thing is to access the channel, we apply one of the persistent strategies, the one of the three strategies that we talked about. Either we sense continuously or we sense at times and so on. Once we find an opportunity to transmit, then we transmit. While we are transmitting, again, we want to detect the collision once it happens, because if the collision ever happens, we need to abstain from transmission. We need to stop sending right away. Okay? So we will, while transmitting, we will keep sensing. We will keep sensing again the channel to know whether or not someone else has sent while I'm sending. So I will keep sensing the channel to know whether there was a collision or not. So the two possibilities here are either collision happened or transmission is done. Okay? So if one of these two events did not happen, yani both events did not happen, then we'll keep transmitting the bits. We convert the bits into signal. We send the signal on the line using bad line coding schemes and so on and so forth. If one of these events happen, if it's not collision, then everything is fine. If it's a collision, then we need to engage in back-off procedure. But there is one slight step here. In Ethernet, if we detect the collision, we send a jamming signal. We might as well inform everyone that there was a collision, so that all the nodes that are engaged in the transmission, whether it's one node, two nodes, three nodes, they can engage in back-off procedure all together. So whenever a node detects a collision, it informs everyone. So jamming signal will be sent on the line while the collision has happened. Okay? Do you accept this? How can you send a jamming signal on the line while there was a collision? Yani collision has happened. And I want to inform everyone, so I will send a jamming signal on a line while the collision is happening. Is this acceptable to you?
No.
Huh? No. How type?
If you keep transmitting them, other people that will send will know it's a collision.
هو الجامينج سيجنال نفسها will collide with the collided signal يعني. صح؟ يعني إذا you have two signals colliding, and you are trying to inform everyone by sending a jamming signal over a signal that's
you let everybody send one signal, one small signal to jam, and then there'll no collision happen. If everybody has one node, which is one small packet or segment that got jammed, that means they'll know that the collision occurs.
لا هو الفكر الوادي. Two nodes are colliding. So the signal on the wire, on the shared medium, is actually a composite signal between more than two nodes, يعني. Two nodes or more. For this signal now is invalid. So you want to inform everyone that there is currently collision happening so that they can stop transmission. But you want to inform them how? By sending a jamming signal over a wire which has a collided signal.
Maybe it has a different signature.
Signature? Different frequency. How can you send two signals at the same time without having to collide? If you send them on two different signals. So the way you do this is by, there is the baseband frequency range. This is for Ethernet transmission. So everybody sends their data in this range of frequency. And this is baseband transmission. In Ethernet, as we said, we don't need to have broadband transmission. It's baseband transmission. Okay, so this is the baseband transmission. And there is a tone signal هنا. This is for sending control messages. One of the very important control messages is the jamming signal. Okay? So this way, if there is a collision, we ensure that the jamming signal will be sent and will be heard by everyone. Because it's a broadcast signal. Everyone will listen to it. Okay? So that's how we send the jamming signal. So everyone will stop transmitting, will engage in backoff. Everyone that's trying to transmit the bomb. ماشي? طيب. So, shared medium, the shared medium now, any shared medium will have three states. One state is the shared medium is idle, which means that none of the nodes is actually sending anything. In that case, the shared medium itself, so we have nodes sending over a shared medium. So this shared medium is either idle, okay, which means that none of the nodes is sending anything, or busy, but good busy, بمعنى أنه only one node is sending. This is good busy because this transmission is well, it's good, okay? This node is getting through and everything is fine. If there are more than one node engaged in the transmission, we have a collision, which is busy also, but this is bad busy, okay? Because everything transmitted during that collision time is useless, and nobody can benefit from it in any way. ماشي? So the idea is, or the question is, can we distinguish between these three states or not? The answer is, it depends. If we're talking about wired networks, yes, you can. You can distinguish between the three states easily. Okay? Why? Because simply, for wired, if you are sending a signal at the first point of the cable, the signal will propagate without losing any energy almost. Why? If you're sending with a power P, you will receive it at the end of the line with power P hat, which is almost P. بمعنى ان the attenuation to the signal over wired networks is negligible. Is not that significant. Why?
Distance.
Because not only the distance, because it's guided, because it's a guided transmission medium. And remember when we talked about UTP, we told you that the UTP cable has outer jacket and things like this to make sure that the power is not dissipating outside the cable. It's guided in one direction and it's going through the cable only. Okay? So in that case, we know that if the cable has a power level which is close to zero, then it's idle. We can account for some noise which has usually a very small power level. Okay, so if it's close to zero, it's idle. If it's around P, then it's good busy or busy, okay? If it's around 2p or more, يعني أكبر من أو يساوي, then there is collision. And we can easily do that with high level of accuracy because of the concept that really the signal does not lose much of its power if it's transmitted through a guided medium. Okay? Any guided medium, like even على فكرة for wireless, واحد يقول لي for يعني guided medium that apply for what? Yes. In one exception, if it's line of sight transmission. For line of sight, اللي هي microwave lengths وكذا, there is one directed beam from one node to another. This is used in some applications. That's a guided transmission using wires. Okay? So in that case, the entire power is concentrated in one direction and it's guided through one path. In wired, this is easy. And in that case, we can detect the different states of the shared medium. We can detect idle from busy from collision. Okay? طيب, what about the case of wireless ba? In wireless, it's very tricky. Why? Because imagine if we have a transmitter, even with omnidirectional antenna, even with omnidirectional, there's no such thing called omnidirectional antennas. Theoretically, it does not exist. If a node listens to this wireless signal at different nodes, the wireless signal will dissipate in all directions. The received power here is different from here, is different from here, is different from here. Okay? Why? Because the wireless signal is dissipating in all directions. So the power is distributed amongst all directions. So depending on your distance to the transmitter and your angle to the to your direction, you will receive a different power. So the best case scenario here, is to be able to distinguish between busy and idle. But there's no way we can detect a collision. Okay? And even the distinction between busy and idle happens with low accuracy, really. Yani if we detect that the power level is above zero, that doesn't mean that there is no transmission happening. Because you may be outside the range of the transmitter. So, if you're outside the range of the transmitter, then you may not actually listen to what the transmitter is trying to send. But that doesn't mean that no one is sending. So even the distinction between the busy and idle happens with low accuracy. But there is no way we can rely on this to detect the busy from collision. That cannot happen. If the accuracy for distinguishing between busy and idle is like 60%, distinguishing between busy and collision will be like 5% or 10%. Why? Because the power variability, depending on the distance and the angle, is quite large. So we cannot really detect busy from collision. We cannot do that. مفهوم الحتة دي مهمة جدا. So that's why we told you that we cannot have collision detection in wireless. But we could have a collision avoidance. So the best way is to try to avoid the collision because we cannot detect it. So our tools or defense weapons in this case is to know that to some extent we can sense that there is transmission in wireless. And even that happens with low accuracy. Okay? So that's why in wireless, what we do is to try to avoid collision using three different methods. Three different methods. One, two, three. Okay? So what will happen is, first, we will continuously sense the channel, sense the, this is a wireless channel, we're trying to sense the air and measuring the power level. Okay? So there could be some noise. So if the power level is above the noise level, this means that the channel is busy, or at least we will interpret it this way. Okay? If the power level is within the noise level, this means that the channel is idle to us. But is this really the case? Maybe yes, maybe no. Okay? So in order to make sure, the first thing we do is to wait for a fixed time. This is called inter-frame spacing. Okay? This is a fixed time. We'll wait for inter-frame spacing and then we will sense again. Okay? Lay, just to make sure that the first one is not false alarm. Okay? So we'll wait for inter-frame spacing. Sense again. If the channel is busy, خلاص ما ذم خلاص ما فيش حاجة نعمل. خلاص we'll have to go back and continuously sense the channel. If the channel is idle, okay, the channel was idle before and now it's idle. Okay, so that increases the chance that the channel is really idle. Okay, طيب. Should we start transmitting? If we start transmitting, other nodes will do the same. We'll wait for inter-frame spacing and then they will send, in which case collision will happen. So we remember, we're trying to be very conservative and avoid the collision because we cannot detect it. So in the second phase, this phase is similar to the random back-off procedure, okay? But this time, without collision happening. So if the channel is still idle, which means that there is a high chance that the channel is idle, we will engage in a random backoff. That was similar to the non-persistent case. Okay? So we will engage in a random backoff. But here, this random backoff, we call it contention because it's slightly different. So what we do here is that we sense the channel is idle, then what we do is that we calculate a random number, صح? ماشي? Depending on the value of K. The value of K is the number of times that we had collision, right? We generate a random number within a specific contention window. And then we start a timer. We start a timer that will expire after this wait time. So we have مثلاً R, we detected a random number R. So R times TP, we will set a timer كده that will fire after R times TP. Okay? طيب, should we fire the timer and wait? No. What we do is that for each TP, we sense the channel again. We also change the channel again. Why? Because if we sense the channel at any TP and we find that the channel is busy, there is no time to wait back. Okay? Then in that case, other nodes have waited for a shorter time and they gained access to the channel. So I don't have to wait anymore. Okay? If we find that the channel is busy at any point, then what we do is that we pause the timer. We pause the timer. If we find that the channel is still idle, we continue on until the timer expires. If the timer expires and we still find that the channel is idle, only then we will access the channel. Meshi? But if at any point in time we detected that the channel is busy, then we'll pause the timer. Okay? And then, after some time, we sense the channel again, until we find it idle, then we resume the timer. Why do we pause the timer and not kill it? Yes, because we want to have fairness. A node that waited for some time doesn't have to go back from zero. Okay? Because we're trying to be fair. So when we find that the channel is busy, we pause the time. Until the channel goes back to idle, then we resume the time. We give the ability to this node to be able to resume from where it stopped. Okay? If we wait for all that time and the channel is still idle, then we'll access the channel. Then, here, the only way for us is just to wait for a timeout. And if we don't receive that acknowledgement, then we know that there was a collision. After all of this, that doesn't mean that there would be no collision, right? There's no way for us to figure out that there was no collision. If we don't receive an acknowledgement, this means that there was a collision or there was some kind of error. But for us, we will do the exact same thing. We will have to go back from the beginning, خالص بقى. Okay, and keep sensing the channel and so on. ماشي؟ طبعا after incrementing K1. طيب. So here we talked about three different phases. The first phase is to wait for a fixed time. And the second phase is to wait for a variable time. The fixed time, hena, is required to increase the accuracy of detecting the correct state of the channel. Okay? Which is to minimize the false alarm. The second phase was to actually avoid the collision by engaging into a back-off procedure while accessing the channel, which is similar to non-persistence, as we said. Okay? Type. In both cases, waiting for a time calls for a very interesting thing. If this time is shorter for a node, this means what? This node has a priority. So, if we make this inter-frame spacing different for each node, this means that the nodes with less inter-frame spacing, they essentially have more priority than the others because they will gain access to the channel before others. Okay? So, by controlling this interframe spacing, by having interframe spacing 1, interframe spacing 2, interframe spacing 3, and so on, we can, in fact, provide some priority schemes to the nodes. Similarly, for the contention window, if we use the contention window with a different length, then we can also provide some priority scheme because a node will generate a random number in different ranges. So in that case, the node that has less contention window, it will essentially have higher priority. Okay? So by controlling those two, I can create some classes, some quality of service classes. In fact, that's exactly what this standard is based on. A2.2.11e is based on providing quality of service based on different interframe spacing and different contention window for different nodes. Okay? So I can give a different priority to different nodes based on these times. Okay? We study this in more details in a course called Multimedia Networks. It's one of the elective courses. The good business case for this is to distinguish, to provide quality of service discrimination, يعني, between مثلا video and audio, or between video and data. Okay, so as we told you before, video requires high quality of service or requires higher priority in transmission. So we probably give the video IFS1 and give data IFS3, okay? Which will essentially give video traffic more priority compared to data traffic. So by doing this, we can provide some priority schemes. Meshi? Any questions? Bye. That's how it looks like. And I wouldn't have wanted to explain this if it wasn't in the book, really, because it's an advanced topic, موضوع priority schemes وكده. It's an advanced topic that we studied in other courses in more details, but since I found that the book actually highlights this without really explaining what it means, so that's why I wanted to explain it. So the inter-frame spacing can also be used to define priority schemes, but it doesn't mention really how and why we want to do this. So how is by providing different interframe spacing or different contention window for different nodes? And why would we do this? To provide a different quality of service depending on traffic types and so on. ماشي? And طبعا, if a station finds that the channel is busy, it doesn't restart the timer. As we said, it pauses the timer. And this really guarantees the fairness. Because I know that every time restarts the timer, so this node will be at a disadvantage compared to other nodes. But instead, the node will pause the timer, and then the next time it will resume the timer. So this way, in the next time, the node will have more priority. So the more time the node waits, the shorter time it has to wait for the following chance of transmission. Any questions so far? So that's how the flow chart looks like. One major thing we notice here is that the back-off procedure has disappeared from this side, right? In fact, it has moved to this side. So the back-off procedure has become the main flow. Okay? So in the main flow here, we find that we do the back-off procedure by choosing random number and so on. So before that, if we find that the channel is idle, we wait for inter-frame spacing, which is a fixed time. And then if it's still idle, this means that there is a high chance that it's really idle. Then we engage a random back-off by calculating the wait time. The wait time is based on random number generated. And then we wait for R time slots. During these R time slots, for every one slot, we have to sense again. Okay? And only after we finish all the R slots and we still find that the channel is idle, that we can engage in real transmission. After we transmit, we wait for a timeout to receive the acknowledgement. If the acknowledgement is not received, then we increment K and go back to the beginning. We don't have to do the random back off here because it's already here. It's in the main flow. Okay? This is one major difference. And there could be yeah, for more accuracy, here, if we find that the channel is busy during the R time slots, then we have to post timer. This is not accounted for in the, but for accuracy, this should be there. Meshi? Meshi, any questions about? So the main major thing here is that the random back-off has moved to the main flow. Move to another topic. طيب, يبقى احنا in the in the collision-based protocols, we discussed three major techniques. Aloha, with its variation, whether it's pure Aloha or slotted Aloha. And slotted Aloha started to introduce the concept of restricted transmission. By putting some restriction on the transmission, we were able to increase the throughput, especially in high system loads, right? And then we said that, okay, so we can use that same concept to put some restriction on the transmission by leveraging the concept of sensing, okay? Which is similar to roundabouts here. If you get into the roundabout, sense and see if there is anyone in the roundabout. If anyone is using that roundabout, then you don't send. If no one is using the roundabout, then you can transmit. And then we talked about the fact that when that does not prevent the collision from happening, and then when it happens, we have two possibilities. Either we can detect the collision, in which case we can act upon it. We can act upon it by stopping to transmit anymore and send the jamming signal. If we cannot detect it, then we can at least try to avoid it using the strategies we talked about. First, waiting for fixed time, interframe spacing, and then doing the random back off using the contention window. Moving to the second category of random access techniques, which is to use controlled access. In controlled access, we assume that there is one controller or arbitrator or moderator to the meeting. And we'll see through these two techniques that there is a third technique which I eliminated, really, lower token passing, because it's obsolete. If you have one controller, you can easily eliminate collision. Why? Because there's one entity that controls the access to the medium.
But if we use the controlled access, wouldn't it mean that it is not a random access?
Yes. It's not random in the sense that it's not random in the sense that we can all access the channel at random times. صح مزبوط. Really, the controller controls systematically and deterministically when a node can access the channel. It's like if we assume that I'm the one who's controlling this meeting. Okay?
But when we were talking about Aloha, you said that it should be fair for all of them. But if we have a controlled access, how can we make it fair for all of them? The rest who want to join?
This is the responsibility of the controller. The controller will make it fair or unfair. Depend. هو بقى خلاص يعني it's a one authority kid. It's his responsibility to guarantee fairness or unfairness.
So we cannot guarantee this all to the controller.
Yes. The advantage here is that by giving the control to one person, collision can be eliminated easily. Very easily we can eliminate collision. Why? Because the controller will say, you talk. So while you are talking, I didn't give the permission to anyone else to talk, in which case there will not be any ad hoc communication or any side discussion. So in which case there will be no collision. Okay? So in that case, we have two techniques. One is based on reservation and the other one is based on polling. For reservation, the controller will arrange the access into two phases. One is what we call reservation phase, and the other one is transmission phase. Okay? During the reservation phase, the nodes will announce their willingness to transmit based on whether or not they have any data to send. Okay? خد بالك, they announce their willingness to transmit, not transmit. They will not transmit the data, but they will transmit one indicator to indicate whether or not they have data to send. And this reservation is organized in small, we call it mini slots. Many slots, very small slots. Each slot is enough to send one byte. بس يعني it's like less than a nanosecond. Yeah. بس organized with the actual number of the nodes in the system. So we have as many slots here as the number of nodes in the system. So here, how many nodes do we have in this system? Four, get them. Five. We have five nodes. صح? So each node knows exactly which mini slot it needs to send if it has data. ماشي? So if node 5 has data, it will send in this time slot, in this mini slot. If node 4 has data, it will send. So here we have, in this transmission, for the first transmission, we have three nodes with data to send. Node 4, node 3, and node 1. So the controller at this point will say, okay, node 1 will send first, and it will take this amount of time. And then node 3 will send with this amount of time, and node 4 will send with this amount of time. But everything is reserved. That's why we call it reservation. Okay? If everything is reserved and controlled by a single controller, node 5 should not send. خالص. Node 3 should not send in the time duration of 1. Okay? So everything is controlled in that case. Here, remember, we have only two scenarios. If we have one main controller and five different nodes, we have only two possible scenarios. A node transmits to the controller. Okay? We call this upstream. Okay? If the controller sends to a node, we call this downstream. In all cases, okay, I do not have any ad hoc communication. This ad hoc communication is not allowed. Okay, so it's always controlled access. Because this ad hoc communication is what we have discussed before, and it causes collision. Okay? Because it's very hard to organize these type of communication without having collision. It's almost impossible. Okay? So here, in the controlled access, we either have upstream or downstream. We don't have any ad hoc. Which is, in reality, is similar to if my cell phone is using Wi-Fi versus Bluetooth. Your phone and my phone can engage in Bluetooth in ad hoc. We don't have to have a centralized controller. In Wi-Fi, the access point acts as a controller. Okay? So... So in here we have a reservation. Reservation, the reservation can be used to optimize the transmission phase. Because in the transmission phase, the controller will only allow the nodes that have data to send during this time. And it will not waste any wait time and allocate it to a node that does not have data to send. Okay? Because we'll talk about this in TDMA and FDMA later on. If I allocate a time to node and this node does not have any data to send, this time is wasted. هتقول لي ما هنا طبعا reservation that wastes time. Yes. So this time is an overhead. Yes. صح. But this overhead is very small. Because these many slots are very, very small. ماشي? So that's That's the reservation phase. The last one is based on polling. So the overhead in the case of reservation is in the reservation many slots. And we need to have many slots, as many as the number of nodes in the system. But hopefully these many slots are very small, in which case the overhead is manageable. For the case of polling, again, we have the two cases. We have the downstream, and we have the upstream. Imagine. For the downstream, the controller wants to send to a particular node. خبالك. We are sending point to point. We're not sending broadcast. In all cases, we want to organize the access to the channel where there is one single communication point to point over a shared line. Imagine. So if the primary or the controller wants to send to a particular node, in that case, we'll not do by a reservation. This is not reservation based. This is based on polling. So the way it works is that first, the controller will send one signal called select. And the primary is selecting a particular person that will be targeted for this particular communication. So it sends a select. This select will be sent over the shared line, طبعاً. Okay? And it will have the address of the node that the controller wants to communicate with. So this node has to say, yes, okay, I'm willing to receive. So this node sends an acknowledgement, and then the controller will send the data, and then the node will say, yes, I acknowledge, I received it. Okay? So during this time, all other nodes, they are not doing anything because they are not selected and they are not allowed to transmit. Meshi? The transmission is controlled by one single controller. Okay? So in the downstream, I'm selecting a node. The node tells me, yes, okay, I'm ready. I'm sending. So for one single transmission now, the overhead is I have three different signals I have to do. Three different signals I have to. Okay? Type. For upstream, the nodes wants to send to the controller. But the controller is controlling the axis. So how do we do this? So the only way is to do polling. Is to say, Muhammad, do you have anything to send? If no, you need to send negative. No, I don't have anything. If yes, then you send. Abdullah, do you have anything to send? So this is a polling. And I do the polling in any order. But the order of the polling is controlled by the controller. Meji? So poll, negative acknowledgement. This A does not have any data to send. Type, pull B, B has data to send, so we'll send right away. It will not send, it will not say, I acknowledge that I have and then send. It merges the two because the transmission is happening from the same node, so it sends the data right away. And then the controller will send back that I received. So this is in the case of uplink. For the case of uplink, I have to pull. So the overhead for the case of downlink, we have three signals, okay, for each transmission. For uplink, we have at least two signals, assuming that we pull the right one. Okay? So in assignment two, we will be able to calculate this overhead, quantify this overhead. It's very easy. It's very easy to give you, مثلا, number of nodes, and assuming that all nodes have data to send, how many of these signals I should send in order to send all the nodes from all the all the data from all the nodes to the controller. And calculate the overhead. Imagine? So it's enough to know that for the case of downlink, we have three control signals for one transmission. For the uplink, we have two control signals for one transmission, assuming that we always pull the node with a data to send. Meshi? In both cases, in both mechanisms, whether reservation or polling-based technique, by having that single controller, we were able to eliminate collision altogether. Meshi? So this is controlled access. If we want to have ad hoc communication without centralized controller, we'll talk about it next time, inshallah. So we need to organize before we get into the communication. We need to have some fixed configuration between us. We're getting into the meeting and we know exactly the turn of everyone. Okay? And regardless of whether anyone has data or not, we have to give him the chance, the full chance, and that may waste time, and we'll talk about this next time, inshallah.